Hello again. Welcome to another episode of Mind Hijacked. You're wondering what I'm doing here in a pharmacy. As you know, I'm a pharmacist and a psychiatrist. Today we're going to talk about how antidepressants work and the many questions that I get asked by patients, like how long does it take for an antidepressant work? What are the side effects? Is a generic drug better than another? Do these medicines really work in the brain? I'll answer these questions towards the end of the video. But now, I'd like to talk to you, what is depression? Why is this such an important topic? Depression is a mental disease with an impairment of brain tissue causing a person to behave in certain ways. They begin to become more despondent, they have no interest in activity, they either eat too much or they undereat, their mood becomes impaired, they're very sad, tearful, they can cry at the hat. They have poor concentration, and the most important thing of all, they begin to think about death. And this is why this is such an important topic. Depression not only affects adults, but believe it or not, it affects children. And you probably heard in very rare occasions, how can a young man so happy can be found dead hanging? And usually that's the cause of death for children. And also, you begin to think, what about the older people? Older people suffer from depression a great deal. So before we go into the aspects of antidepressants, let me give you some background information on the statistics. I'm about to read to you, why is depression such an important problem in this country? You know, before up to the year 2015, 6 or 7% of full-time employees had major depression. The total economic burden on productivity totaled $210 billion a year. A lot of money. That's in the form of time loss, time off from work. The other thing, 40% of that $210 billion was related to cost of depression, such as medication and hospitalizations. Now I like to read to you, why is depression such an important illness? Because depression falls on one of the top 10 conditions of people dying in this country. For example, there are 10 diseases in this country that kill us. Heart disease, cancer, accidents, respiratory disease, Alzheimer's, diabetes, and depression stands at number 10. That's pretty significant. And number 10 in the sense of suicide. So why is depression, how is it distributed? It is believed that between the 2013 and 2016, 8.1% of Americans, adults over the age of 20, suffered from depression. Women, 10.4% of them, were almost twice as likely as men to have depression. And 80% of people who have depression cannot work and function. This is why depression is such an important topic. And this is why I bring this to your attention. Before we go into medication, I'm just going to give you a very brief journey as to where depression comes from. Let's use my magic microscope and MRI, and let's take a journey into the brain. I use the word journey because it is exciting to see what the brain is about. Depression appears to affect the prefrontal cortex, a special part of the brain that is above to the side of your ear and above. It also seems to be related to an area we call the hippocampus and the limbic lobe. I'm not going to get too specific, but I wanted to see how depression, where depression is affected. There are many medications, and I need to tell you something about depression. When I was in training back in 1990, it was believed that there was a brain imbalance. You know, many patients come to my office and they ask me, doctor, is depression an imbalance of chemicals? It's a very good question. A lot has changed since 1990. We do know that on a molecular level, depression seems to be affected because there's a low amounts of certain substances that are inside your brain, and that includes serotonin, norepinephrine, and dopamine. That's what we believe it was. However, new studies have shown that even though this appears to be the explanation. It doesn't correlate to the MRI findings and the actual outcomes when medications are given. We do know that if we increase the amount of that neurotransmitter on the synapse, you will see that the patient has an improved mood. So how do these medicines work? The purpose of these medications is to stimulate already natural substances such as norepinephrine and serotonin, as well as dopamine. In doing so, we try to restore a balance. But mind you, we now know that there are new reasons as to why depression seems to come. And the most exciting things yet to come, and will be part of a future episode, is it appears that inflammation, yes, if you have an inflammation, it appears that cortisol is playing such an important role. And why is cortisol so important? Because cortisol is related to stress. Have you heard people saying that stress causes depression? True, but they never knew why. It appears that high levels of cortisol appears to cause cell death. The future probably will be, and they're doing great studies of anti-inflammatory drug, very similar to aspirin and Motrin. The studies are yet to come, and we will soon find out. But the implications is that depression is caused by could be caused by an infection or some form of inflammatory process. This is why people who have diseases of the immune system seem to have problems with depression, such as rheumatoid arthritis. There seems to be increased association between depression and these diseases. Now, let's talk about the medications. One of the biggest questions I get is, how soon do these medications work? In reality, and back in the 1990s, we were trained to say that if the medicine doesn't take effect within 8 weeks, it's ineffective. But we're learning now that genetics plays a much more important role. In an episode in my YouTube channel, you can learn more about pharmacogenetic testing. So one of the things we start to do is by matching the genetic makeup of your genes with the right medicine. And there are 5 categories of medication. Each medication impacts the brain in different areas. We try to choose the one with the least side effects. So it's often said that these medications make you happy, but they take away your intimacy. So it kind of contradicts each other. And so pharmaceutical companies have come out with newer medicine with supposedly better efforts. We do know like drugs like Wellbutrin have the least sexual side effects, and the newer ones such as Trintellix also seems to improve mood without affecting side effects such as sexual dysfunction. The goal of many pharmaceutical companies is to come up with drugs that this is not seen. Another thing is the newer drugs that are coming out also it seems to improve your memory and your ability to concentrate, because we do know that depression is associated with poor memory, concentration. So the ideal antidepressant is one that doesn't affect your sex drive. It improves your mood and it improves your memory. We're getting very close to that. From the moment you swallow a tablet, it goes right into your stomach through the esophagus. There it gets dissolved, and these medications get absorbed, usually in the intestine. I always tell people, if it's a sustained release medication, do not crush it. You will do damage to the treatment. Sustained release medicines cannot be crushed as they become ineffective. When the medications land in the intestines, it gets absorbed into the blood. And then it has to take this journey through the liver. It is here in the liver that genetically it finds a way to metabolize it into these different compounds. Some antidepressants are not the active ingredient. Some antidepressants have to go to the liver to make it the active ingredient. Once the active ingredient is made in the liver, it goes to a special place called the blood-brain barrier. Remember, the blood-brain barrier protects things from going in. So medications are designed, they have to be able to cross that blood-brain barrier. Once in the blood-brain barrier, it begins to saturate the receptors. Now, does it mean that it's going to work right away? No. Some people will start noticing effects within 2 weeks when they can see this gush of neurotransmitters going from one synapse to another. And I want to make a comment here. One of the products that seems to be coming out more is something we call ketamine. I do not have enough experience. Now, ketamine is like a stimulant. It's a form of medication that seems to improve your mood in a very fast way. Things that you can do naturally to improve your mood. Yes, you can. One of the systems that we have in our body is called the endogenous opioid systems. It appears that people who exercise have improved mood and reduced anxiety. Certain nutraceuticals are believed to have these benefits, although the studies are very mixed. Items such as St. John's wort, certain products such as glycine, certain products such as rhodiola, which reduces your cortisol levels, are yet to be examined. The other side effect of these medications is that they cause insomnia. Not a good idea. If you're depressed, why give a medicine that causes insomnia when you cannot sleep, which means you have to add another medicine? So what is the trick in treating depression? You have to combine the medicine into the person's symptoms. As you know, I'm also a registered pharmacist. I'm now going to put my pharmacy hat. The thing with medications, even though they're better, the newer one are very expensive. We're talking in the thousands of dollars. And many insurance companies want you to fail or need to fail the standard medicine before they actually approve the new medicines. A medication can be costly, about $900 a month. Now, that comes to about $12,000 a year. That's half a person's salary. Insanity, isn't it? So picking the right medicine is important. And one of the things I get asked all the time is a generic drug better than a brand name? There are things you need to know, and this is where I'm putting my pharmacy hat. The most important things about tablets, and there is a standard of manufacture. Tablets have to be hard, they cannot dissolve in the container, and they have to dissolve correctly in your gut to be absorbed and go to your brain. The key issue that I want to tell my patients, don't be hijacked into thinking that a generic drug is of lesser quality in terms of response than a brand name. What happens a lot, medications are in the market for 10 plus years. After 10 and plus years, the medication can no longer be a brand name because now companies can manufacture them in a generic form. So a drug that used to be $900 only costs $10. And there are many programs out there by pharmacies where they can help you. I am here today at a very good pharmacy called Misir. This pharmacy is well respected and with a good reputation in Naples. They provide compounding and they provide a great deal of patient education. Thank you once again for coming to my channel, Mind Hijack. And this channel, I'd like you to like and subscribe, and please continue to give me feedback. There will be future episodes on what you need. Thank you once again, and I will see you next week.